thanks for having me again. It's been a couple months, I guess. So I thought it was due to come see y'all again. So appreciate you having me. So I'll just tell you a little bit about what I've been up to. It's been very busy. Obviously, spring buying season's heating up. I think everyone's experiencing that. So we're very grateful for a lot of stuff going on, and we're building our team, so we're bringing on some people, and that's exciting too. Probably a lot like you all in a lot of the real estate offices. It's so easy, anyone can do it right now, right? but a lot of fun right now. So I when I reached out about doing this, I had some ideas in my head of what I might want to talk about, and busyness took over, and so I'm totally winging this today. So I apologize for that. I reached out to Joey and Matt this morning and said, hey, give me some ideas and some things that might be hot topics or burning questions and whatnot. And so
I asked about Dogecoin.
Dogecoin. Oh, right.
can I buy a house with Dogecoin?
So if nothing else, we can eat lunch and hang out together for a few minutes. So some questions that came up, and I'll try to tackle these best I can. Y'all have seen a lot of, every deal probably is a multiple offer situation, right? I mean,
yeah.
Every time. Unless it's, I mean, is there ever a situation right now, something's on, unless it's way overpriced or it's a dump? I mean, there's more than, there's, what's an average number of offers right now on a decent house?
Shoot, 5 to 10.
5 to 10 mm-hmm. or more, maybe, yeah. So the question was, can we the lender pre underwrite the borrower? So help me if I'm misunderstanding the question, but can we pre underwrite to help the borrower have maybe an upper hand on getting their offer accepted?
Yeah, it's kind of like, hey, absolutely. We could potentially close a lot sooner since we've already sent all the stuff to underwriting type things, and now it's just kind of checking these last couple boxes and just
forward. Absolutely, yeah. So and that's something that I've gotten a habit of doing more lately too, is when I pre-approve someone, because when we do a pre-approval, we're not generally requesting full documentation. Unless it's a self-employed borrower, there's some things about their situation that gives us questions about the validity of what they're telling us. But as you all probably know, pre-approval is really just based on the borrower's credit score and what they're telling us about their income, their assets, and their overall financial situation. So unfortunately, we run into surprises because of that, because we either misunderstood or they weren't being completely honest or upfront, or maybe they didn't know about, you know, how their income has been quantified, or, you know, based on tax returns or whatnot. So so I've been getting in the habit of, you know, pre-approving someone plus asking for that information. It helps me, the lender, from a competitive standpoint, because the more information I can get from my client, the more they're tied into working with us, and maybe the less likely they are to shop. So I don't know if y'all have any tactics like that you can do to kind of like lock down a client. But it gives us a reason to solidify the relationship and actually look at what they're giving us relative to what's in their application. Because if it doesn't match, then, you know, underwriting's going to say, well, hey, this, you know, where did you get these numbers from? So I think that certainly we can do that. We don't always do it, but for self-employed folks, that's kind of become a matter of practice anyway. Just because a lot of our small business clients, they don't have a great handle on their income. They kind of have an idea, but when it comes to you know deductions and how they file their taxes, sometimes there's a pretty good gap between what they say and what's on paper. So. Does that answer that question?
Mm-hmm. I do have another question along those lines. In what instances would you guys be able to waive an appraisal?
Waive an appraisal. So when typically we'll get those, and we call those PIWs, property inspection waivers, through Fannie or Freddie, but we won't get those unless it's a conventional 20% down type of deal. Pretty rare to get on a purchase. Get them more often on refis, but they're going to have a pretty good, they're going to have, I think, at least 20% down payment. And these are Fannie and Freddie guidelines. And that's a good question. I I probably could look into more of what exactly the parameters have to be for that. There could be a credit score element. There could be a debt to income ratio element to that. But I know you don't have a chance if they're not putting at least 20% down.
Yeah.
So if it's FHA or if it's, we're not going to be able to do that. So conventional, and those are always nice. That's a fun phone call to make. Say, hey, guess what? We don't have to have a appraisal done. So you save the $500 or whatever it is, plus the timing and, and the hassle of all that. So,
awesome.
Yeah. There's a question about what are upfront fees for someone who's low on cash? And so that upfront fees being like what, not closing costs, but that like upfront to get the ball rolling on all this. What am I going to fork out? So from our standpoint, really the appraisal is the main one. Now in your world, they choose to have an inspection done. I guess most buyers are choosing to have an inspection done. Termite. Of course, we don't really handle that part of it. But the appraisal is typically charged up front. We, in previous companies I've worked for, we didn't charge that client the appraisal till closing. My last company, we didn't do that. I didn't really like that practice because if the deal fell through, guess who's paying for the appraisal? Now some clients will come in and pay it, but that's tough, especially if there was no relationship and if they were marginal credit worthy to begin with, then it's like a blow from a turnip sometimes. We make a practice of in their initial doc set, with their initial disclosures that they review and sign, one of the first documents is a credit card authorization form for the appraisal. So they fill out their credit card info. We don't hit that card until the appraiser is actually starting with that order. So it might be, the bid gets accepted, and then maybe a week goes by before the appraiser actually starts that order. That's when they'll hit that card. And then so I always tell the client, hey, look out for this. This is about when it's going to be charged. And then it's that much less they have to bring to closing because they've already paid for it on their credit card. So they get credit card points for it. But that's the main one in our world. Can't think of anything else. So,
what are some troubles that y'all are dealing with as things are heating up?
Appraisal turn times.
Okay, is that still bad?
It's we're seeing a little bit of a trend. We've seen this for a little while. Appraiser is not actually delivering the report by the due date, which is extremely frustrating.
Yep.
We have some really good appraisal liaison folks, management, inside the management companies, who are really persistent. But at the end of the day, we're at the mercy of the appraiser. We have some good ones, but when we expect the appraisal to come in by a certain date, and the client is, and the agent is, and we don't get it, that's hard for me to swallow.
At the end of the day, there's nothing you can do.
Not much you can do. My cousin's an appraiser, and we were talking about it over the weekend. We took a hiking trip, and we were talking about it. And he's over in Western North Carolina, but he was telling me about his turn times, what he's charging, or what it's just amazing what appraisers can charge, and what some people will pay. But there's only so many appraisers out there, and they can do it. So that's one thing that comes to mind.
Is there some sort of something they could do, and do you have a practice of making sure that the client understands your separation between you and the appraiser? I found a lot of people are like, well, so-and-so, this is their fault. Why would they give me this appraiser? Like, they don't give you the appraiser.
Yeah. No, so like most mortgage companies, we're highly regulated. We can't have contact with the appraiser. We have to use a third-party management company. Some companies have in-house appraisal divisions who manage that. Other companies have, VMC, vendor management company, or AMCs, whatever you want to call it. We have one that we use more than anyone. Axis does a really good job. We also use valuation partners, haven't been as happy with them. So we're steering most of our orders to Axis. There's actually one appraiser who gets most of our orders who I've been working with since I think 2004. And he does a really good job, but he's busy, you know. Mm-hmm. And so it is helpful where I can, well, I'm not gonna say that.
Yeah.
We can do things to maybe remind and, you know.
What's that?
I said,
"Darn
Karen and her big guy." I know, right? Let's see. Which government program is most strict? USDA, VA, FHA. Now, I think a lot of people think VA loan is very strict, and there's hesitation, and I don't think that's the case. I think there's a lot of paperwork, and there's a lot of things in place to protect the veteran, which there should be. We've seen, for one, on the debt-to-income ratio, oftentimes you can go well over 50% and get an approval on it for a veteran, I mean, which is just crazy, gross income. Property issues that maybe an issue with USDA or FHA sometimes aren't an issue with VA. There's still things, but we had one where there was some peeling paint, there were some other issues with the house that didn't end up being an issue. So USDA probably, just for the fact that there's the USDA layer of approval and review.
How long is that process taking now?
As of the other day, they were working on applications that were submitted, I think, 4 days prior.
Oh, wow.
So they were pretty, believe it or not, even this time of year, they're pretty caught up. And then when you see that on the site, oftentimes they're working through them faster than what that indicates. So that's a good sign. It may change over the summer.
Yeah.
But it's really not that bad right now.
That's good.
Yeah. But, you know, the fact there's that extra layer of approval that might make it a little more strict, I guess. Not to mention the fact that USDA, there's more defined parameters around income limits, property eligibility from the geographic standpoint, you know, where it is. Debt-to-income ratio is more tight, you know. 41% is kind of the automated approval threshold, and up to 45% on a manual underwrite. But, whereas FHA, VA, 57% maybe, you know, based on credit score, based on some other things. there are deals we can get done through FHA that we couldn't come close to touching on USDA. So credit score too, FHA, you know, down to 620, VA 620, whereas USDA is 640. So USDA is one of my favorite loans. If someone can qualify for it. VA, maybe more so, but if they can qualify for USDA, I'd much rather go that route versus FHA. Just for the borrower, the funding fee is 1% versus 1.75%, so it's almost half. The PMI is less than half for USDA. There's no money down, so I don't see the negative. I mean, now, if you can go conventional, not pay the funding fee, great. Oh, the interest rates are great too. So you can get a better rate on a government loan these days than a conventional one. You've got the PMI, but sometimes the payments seem better.
The reason why I ask that is because I think as agents come in the real estate world and start talking to lenders right off the bat, they're automatically ingrained to be taught like, oh, VA is super hard and super strict.
Right.
I should never accept this. It's going to be so hard. And then it's kind of just hit or miss up to the appraisal. Because I've had FHA loan shut down my loan because they want to turn on the water and there's minerals and the like solid in the faucet. So they just unscrewed it, tapped it out, screwed it back up, and he came back out and was like, "You're good." I was like, "What?"
Right.
And so I just wanted to, it's good to hear your
they're on a well, there's a well water test that's required.
Septic, or just well?
I think just well.
Foundation inspection still required for FHA manufacturing engines?
Can you go over the timeframe for us? Because I don't think it's talked about a ton. If we have, especially in this market, there are so many flips that are happening. And if we have a client that doesn't have a lot of money to put down, but they can swing the 3.5%, can do FHA, that appeals to them the most. What is the time frame of a house being flipped before it's eligible to be used for FHA?
So it can be used after 90 days. The FHA loan can work after 90 days. So if it's inside of 90 days, you can't.
Okay.
If it's between 90 and 6 months, then it's very likely that they'll have to have a second appraisal done on the property. And that second appraisal must be paid for by the seller.
Really? Okay.
Yes.
I didn't know that it had to be paid for by the seller.
We just had one.
That's okay.
A month or two that was between the 90 and 180, and it all came together. We were a little delayed because the second appraisal took like a month to get back, but it came back and it was good and it closed. So.
Okay.
Yeah. And it was a great house. I mean, the house was completely redone. It was over in Carter County, and it was like a new house. But
90 days for. It to be clean, and then after 180 yeah. days.
After 180 days,
it's just normal FHA.
Normal.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And is that the time that it is purchased and then up on the market, or is when it's completed, or how does
purchase goes by the purchase date?
Okay.
Of the seller.
Okay.
When they bought it.
Cool.
Yeah,
cool.
Good questions. Yeah. Yeah. A lot of flips. Are y'all seeing that? A lot of flips up there.
Yeah, especially for the lower price points. If there's any, I was telling one group they were coming in and they're approved up to 250, but of course they'd like to be under the 200s. And I said, under the 200s, you're going to be seeing a lot of flips.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of some are done well, some are not done so well.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, I've run into that more and more at a lower price point, more of a median price point.
Right.
Yeah. So it's good to know about FHA. I've been bit by that a few times.
Yeah.
It's no fun. Everybody's excited, and they're like,
what do you mean?
Yeah, when I get a contract, I always go on the courthouse retrieval and just look at that, when it was bought, whether or not it's in the flood zone. That's always good to know kind of early on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's helpful.
Know, we just closed one last week for a borrower who had to have flood insurance, and poor lady, started out thinking her payment was going to be this, and then... And the homeowners was hired, and the shop could bought and the flood insurance. And it's like,
But are there any loans that if it's in a flood zone that they won't cover it? Just the general, or are they just going to make them get the flood insurance?
Just have to get it. Some areas have, you can get the private policies. You've all seen that, get all the flood. And those aren't that bad.
And all that.
Yeah. And then if it has to be through the, I guess, the NFIP or the standard flood insurance, and it depends on what zone it's in, and but boy, that is not fun to pay. And no one ever thinks their house is going to flood, right?
Oh yeah, that's super fun trying to sell one.
Yeah,
this house is going to go to water, isn't it? And I'm like, I don't know.
It could be. I don't know.
Maybe.
What can you tell me about a short sale?
Well, there's probably not a whole lot of this going on right now, but a short sale is when the homeowner needs to sell, but they can't sell it for what they owe on it, and they don't have the resources to pay the loan down, and so they go to the lender and say, hey, if I sell it for X, will you forgive the difference? As opposed to getting sued for the difference, having a judgment on the credit, anytime they go to apply for a loan or buy another house, that would have to be satisfied prior to being able to obtain new essentially says, hey, I'll sell the house for, let's say there's $100,000 owed on it. I'll sell it for $75,000. You're going to forgive the $25,000, and the lender agrees to do that. And I was going to show as such on a credit for a while, but it won't hit them nearly as hard as a foreclosure or a bankruptcy. So it's wonderful for the homeowner to get out from under something.
But that's the first step to foreclosure, or is that an option for all? Or
well, it's different than foreclosures. Because foreclosure would be, hey, I'm handing you the keys, I can't make this payment, and then the lender would
not
then.
Willing to pay any like that. So I'm just done with it. That kind of instant. Okay.
Maybe they lost their job or whatever, or they can't sell it for what is owed, and so the lender would then start the foreclosure process, and then try to sell it at the courthouse steps, and probably buy it back, and then they'll put it on the market and sell it. And then more than likely, it's not going to sell for what was owed on it. So that difference, they're going to go back to the homeowner for, and essentially sue them for it, which would be a judgment on their credit, which would be terrible. So a short sale it's not a great situation, but compared to a foreclosure, it's a way to get out from under something.
Or bankruptcy.
Yeah. I bought a condo about 6 or 7 years ago from a guy who, this is long before this crazy market, but he bought a condo for $100,000. I don't know what he owed on it, but I bought it for a lot less, and the bank, it was a regional bank, they approved it. Surprisingly, I thought they were going to counter, and they just wanted off their books and knew that they probably wouldn't get paid back. So,
in an appreciating market, it is interesting. We actually are coordinating a short sale right now. Because it is an appreciating market, it is a crazy market, and yet here we have the short sale. Mm-hmm. So we were talking to Tim about Tim's out, and he was saying that he probably expects it just to be terminated because he doesn't expect the bank to actually go through with it
right.
In an appreciating market. And it's interesting because even though the seller is in the short sale, the seller is paying for basically the house to be redone.
Yeah, like new floors.
Like new floors.
New kitchen. New bathroom. New
completely
roof.
Remodeled. So it's a very, it doesn't seem like it is a short sale. It doesn't seem like it qualifies or that it's actually a situation where the seller wouldn't be able to pay.
So I'm curious, when did they buy the house?
Bought a decent time ago, last time I checked.
Did they just keep refinancing and pull equity out?
It could have been. I'm not sure.
It's just hard to believe anyone's underwater on a house right now.
Yeah. And it's in Irwin, and it's for like $200,000. And so, how are you?
And they're really doing everything to make it look like a brand new house. And they had rented it out, too.
It was a rental.
It was a rental. And so they had to have been making money off of it. But it just doesn't really make any sense.
It doesn't.
But we have to treat it as a short sale because that's what it's categorized as. So we have the buyer side, though, so it is a little bit different because we're not dealing with the seller or the seller's lender or anybody.
Mm-hmm.
But we're just kind of suspicious about it because I don't know if this is actually going to...
I can't imagine lenders right now being too eager to write off something like that, knowing what kind of market virtually everywhere is.
It's just so interesting. But they have a letter. They have a letter from the bank.
Approving
the short sale.
Interesting.
But we're not sure that people are going to be in that way.
We'll figure it out. I just told the guy, I was like, we'll start inspections once they finish all the repairs and see how it goes. Alright, I don't want to close too quick. I was like, it's not going to be a problem. It's like, hang tight.
So I wonder how long it took from the initial request until the bank or the lender approved it. Because that can be a long time.
Now it could have been. I don't know that.
How long do you usually see for that?
Oh, it could be 6-8 months. Just. Wow. I think on my own that several years ago it was only 3 or 4. I was very fortunate for some reason. But
even last year's market was crazy. So even if they had started the process 6, 7, 8 months ago, I don't see why they would have still approved it.
Job loss, loss of income, maybe. But even still, you think that we could sell it for, you know, more than they would be writing off on the short sale.
We'll see how it plays out.
They're not very, I'll let you guys know.
Yeah. So I, on that subject, I don't know, we are hearing, and I don't really stay completely up to date with the latest on the foreclosure announcements, but it sounds like there could be, it could be a little while longer until we start seeing foreclosures hit the market. Is that what y'all are hearing?
Yeah, I don't, I mean, the whole process of it actually going through is going to take a lot longer. Like, a lot of folks are like, it could happen at any moment. You know, like, forbearance takes a long time for the, somebody in forbearance to get to foreclosure, for the foreclosure process to start. So it's like a few years back is what I was reading or something like that. Right. I mean, what does it take, about a year, like, once someone is, like, going into foreclosure for it to actually force back up? So... Because right now, I'm sure everybody's conversation is, if you have, there's always like a few buyers that are like, well, you know the market's going to crash.
Right.
You don't know that.
Yeah. I don't know. Our government's been pretty ready and willing to step in and not let that
happen. Have you seen how much money we threw at the Fed?
Yeah.
When there was like an inkling of any type of depression?
Right.
Like,
right.
Friend.
Right. Yep.
We shall see.
Indeed. This last question I had was a fixed rate versus adjustable. We don't see a lot of adjustable rate requests these days. I mean, you know, we've been here lately in what we call a rising rate environment. And it's not really going up fast, but I think everyone's expectation is that rates are moving upward, or have to at some point. And they have the last couple months or so. I was talking to someone yesterday who, they were in a contract on a house over on Lamont Street, and the house flooded. It was a flip. It was like a remodel, and someone, whoever did the plumbing, did something a little wrong where it caused the something to break. Anyway, it flooded, and then when they locked the rate back in, I don't know, February maybe, it was 2.875. Now, you know, their lender is saying, well, now we can't honor that rate because we've already extended it, and, you know, and that now, so anyway, it's certainly impacting, you know, mortgage rates. So we're seeing somewhat of a rise, but all in all, historically very low. I mean, I'm locking people around on a conventional loan that are low threes on a 30-year fixed. Government loans, probably high twos, you know, without points. I mean, they can buy the rate now if they want. When I was at the bank for a couple of years, we were doing a lot of ARMs, which are adjustable rate mortgages, just because we're in a low rate environment and there's no expectation they're going to go up. And so if you can get a low rate on the ARM versus the fixed rate, And we could do, at that time, we could do a 7 or a 10 year ARM. And so a lot of people thought, well, that's plenty of time for me to, I mean, I don't want to live in this house that long, or am I going to be financed or fixed rate or whatever. So, but lately, not too many requests for ARMs. Does that answer that question?
Yeah, could you do one?
I could.
Okay.
Yeah.
What would that look like?
But you know, based on the rate, the yield curve, on how rates are, a lot of people are surprised to hear. And we kind of saw this with 15-year and 30-year rates, where for a while they're kind of level. Like, there's not much difference between a 15 and a 30. And in normal markets, you'd see a pretty big spread there. You know, the shorter the term, the less risk to the lender. And so, when I was pricing ARMs a little while back, there was they were higher. The rate was higher than a fixed rate. I mean, it didn't make any sense, but that's the way it was. So why in the world would you get an adjustable rate higher than a fixed? But I haven't priced, I haven't even looked at them in so long, so I couldn't even tell you what they are. They're, you know, no one's asked me.
I'm not really a fan of them.
Yeah. And the way they work is they're fixed for a specified period of time. So usually you see them 3, 5, 7 years. That's kind of the typical adjustable rate period, or fixed rate periods, and then beyond, now they're amortized on a 30-year or 20 or 15 or whatever.
Okay.
But after that fixed period, they can adjust, and there's different ways they can adjust. Some they'll adjust once a year on the anniversary, you know, with a cap. Like say, you know, in the loan document, it might say it's a 5-2-5. So every 5 years, it can adjust. It can't go more than 2% or down 2% each adjustment period, with a lifetime cap of 5% over the initial rate, something like that.
Okay.
And there's different ways to structure them. Or they adjust every 5 years. So your first period is fixed for, say, 5 years. It adjusts at that fifth year, and then it won't adjust again until the 10th year. So there's different ARM products out there. But again, I haven't really had that conversation with anyone.
Those ARM rates, do they have prepayment penalties?
No.
No.
No. You don't really see too many lenders doing prepayment penalties these days. Some lenders will, if the loan is paid off, and within a certain amount of time that the loan was from when the loan was originated, they may claw back some revenue to the lender, the originator. That's no fun, but so stuff happens. People buy a house and then they have to immediately sell it, or they have a windfall and they can pay it off. But when lenders like us originate a mortgage, we do so, and we sell it. If we sell it, we're doing the purchaser of that mortgage is doing so with the expectation they're going to generate interest income, servicing income for hopefully years. So when that doesn't happen, then they're not very happy. But there's no penalty to the borrower. They can pay it off tomorrow. You see that, you see prepayment penalties more in the commercial world, where banks will put a loan on the books, and their sole income is more on the interest income. If they don't make that, then they put a lot of effort into making that loan. They want to see it last for a while. So you see them on the commercial side a lot more often.
Okay.
Whole nother conversation. You see prepayment penalties 3-5%. Sometimes they're stepped down, like after year one, it'll go from 5-4 3-2-1. Maybe go away after 5 years. So, pretty exciting stuff.
Yeah.
Not for the buyer. Not to pay that off.
Can you go into some detail a little bit about paying down a rate? I know that can be a bit foreign to folks.
Yeah.
Because these big companies will advertise a certain interest rate.
Yeah.
And they're like, ha-ha, I can get it online for this, but they don't know how much closing costs they're assuming is to be paid down into that.
Well, that's the whole thing with online lenders. That's the whole way they get people's attention. I mean, they have to get their attention. They do so with the rate, because to the average Joe consumer, what's my rate? What's my rate? What's my payment? And so, so when you go into LendingTree or BankRate and see a rate advertised, then more often than not, there's going to be what's called discount points associated with that rate. So what you're doing is you're essentially prepaying interest. You're buying your rate down with more upfront money at closing. And so those are called discount points. You're discounting the rate with points.
Okay.
Some lenders call it just points or origination. Most lenders like us, we don't really have an origination fee. Like I think more of the local banks and credit unions call it an origination fee. For us, we have an admin fee of $7.50, a processing fee of $5.95. So that's what, $13.45 total. That's what we get for processing the loan and administrating the loan. And then if the buyer wants to buy down their rate, we can talk about points. So if a borrower as they're considering options, and if they're really concerned about getting the best deal and understanding what they're paying as far as rate, what they really need to be doing is looking at what the annual percentage rate is. And so Regulation Z created a way for consumers to be able to compare apples to apples between lenders. And so as a lender, you can't just say, well, our rate is 2.5%. 2.5%, you'll say my IRA is 2.5%, our APR is 2.99, whatever. And that way, that APR is reflecting not only the rate, but rate plus fees.
Okay.
So APR is your rate as expressed as an annual cost of your loan. So a consumer can say, okay, I've got an APR of 3.25 here versus APR of 3.375. That way they can set, you know, see that that's more the total picture versus, well, just the rate.
So much shopping, yeah. that's like the meat and potatoes you want to look at.
Right. It's a way to compare to see which is the better cost.
Okay.
Because the discount points are, it's just a way to get paid that interest sooner for the lender, essentially.
Okay.
Now, the longer a borrower plans to have the loan or be in the house, the more it might make sense to buy that rate down because they'll recoup that over time with the lower interest.
Yeah. But if they're like trying to move in like 2-3 years, probably like this one.
It's 2 or 3 years, I would say you probably don't want to buy your rate down at all.
Yeah.
That's where a local lender can help.
Yeah.
Make it make sense for people. So that's all the questions I was thrown at here. So that's all I got here. But what else? Anything else on those lines?
Well,
running dry with content.
Okay. Well, thank you, David. Thanks for coming.